last week, what he was asking them, when you look this up now, and what we call the drush. Last week I said it was the remez, but it was actually the drush double. What he's actually saying is, Aika, which he's asking Adam and Eve, you know, where is the light? And the light is Torah. And we know that Yahushua HaMashiach was a living, walking, okay, Torah. Everybody's told with that, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So we talked about that in Bereshit 3 and 9. You can also, in Bereshit, the third chapter, we have Yahuwah Elohim calling out to Adam and speaking to them both about their transgressions and also giving them the opportunity to return by providing a temporary covering, okay, or atonement. Let's take a look at the word quote in Hebrew, Genesis 3:21. Watch how this whole thing, it goes full center. Book of Genesis, the third chapter, and to Adam, also, and to his wife, did Yahuwah make coats of skins. The first word I want to look at is the word coats. And the word coats is the Strong's number 3801. And it's the Hebrew word, we have a kuf, okay, a tha, or a tau. We have a nun and another thou. We have kephoneth. And it means now a tunic, an undergarment, a long shirt-like garment, usually of linen. In the Brown's Driver's Briggs, the Old Testament in Hebrew English lexicon, it comes from an unused root meaning to cover. All right? It means to cover. So now we have a situation where the transgression happened in the garden, because they're no longer walking in the light, and the Messiah is the light. And so we see now that a temporary covering was given to both Adam and Eve. And it comes from the word, okay, cover. Also, let's look at the Strong's number 3802 in relation to the word coat. Watch how interesting this gets now. The word kataf, it comes from an unused root meaning to clothe. Watch the Hebrew word study, transliteration, pronunciation, etymology, and grammar of the word. It has shoulder, shoulder blade, the side slope, the shoulder blade of a man, shoulder pieces of animals. That's going to be the key that we're going to be looking at here, because we're talking about an atonement. The shoulder of an animal. An animal was slaughtered, okay, in order to atone or temporary covering for both Adam and Eve. And we have here now in the Strong's number 3802, the word kataf, and we have the word shoulder. Now, let's go to the book of Leviticus and watch how this all ties in. What in the world does a shoulder of an animal have to do with all of this here? The book of Leviticus. The 10th chapter. I'm going to tell you, when you look at it in Hebrew, it makes a whole lot better sense. Leviticus, I'm going to start at verse 1, read down to 15. Watch what's happening here. And pay very close attention. And Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aharon, took either of them his censer and put fire therein, and put therein incense therein, and offered strange fire before Yahuwah, which he commanded them not. So again, you can't do your own personal thing. When the Father gives you instructions on how to do things, you must follow it to the letter. This is the reason why I said earlier, it is not about your feelings. The Torah answers all questions. Any problem, any situation that's going on in your life, Torah has the solution to the problem. You might not like the solution, because I've heard things like, well, I hear what you're saying, Nike, but I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to sleep on it, I'm going to pray on it, and it's almost like the person is waiting for a messenger to come from Shamayim and say, I am all right, whatever is going on in your life, you must do that. You know, that's not how that's happening, all right? Listen, Moshe was given instructions. Listen, you know what? Set up judges and elders, those that fear Yahuwah and that are willing now to follow all of Torah. This is what, how you're going to get the answers to your situation. And we just pray that the people that the Father is setting up has your interest or your best interest at heart.
Hallelujah.
That's the way that it works. All right? You can't rub a genie lamp and, you know, that's not how that works. All right? So, anyway, let me speed it up here. And they went out fire from Yahuwah and devoured them, which is Nadab and Abihu, and they died before Yahuwah. Then Moshe said unto Aharon, this is that Yahuwah speaks, saying, I will be set apart, a sanctified in them that come near me. And before all the people I will be esteemed. And Aharon held his peace. Okay, the father's busy here. He's at work. His two sons had died. Aharon held his peace. Because right now we're in the presence, or the divine presence of Yahuwah. I gave you instructions on how to do these sacrifices here, but you decide that you want to do it your way. Your two sons, that they just died. The ceremony must continue. Let's keep it moving. All right? Let's keep it moving. It's going to be like that even during the time of the Exodus. All right? There's going to be people now that's going to give you problems. You know what? It's going to be up to you. You might have to keep it moving. Listen, those are your problems. Those are your issues. We've been rehearsing these righteous acts for the last 15, 20, 25 years now. Now that it is showtime, it's time for us to move. All of a sudden, well, what about my mama? And what about my jobs? You're going to have to now leave all those things behind. And what I want to do, which I believe, that the Father is going to be the ultimate provider. The way that he was the ultimate provider in the wilderness. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to even go as far as to say this. Is that, I'm not telling nobody not to store up goods and things of that sort. I'm not telling nobody to do that. But you're not going to be redeemed by your hands. Hallelujah. You're not going to be able to say, listen, this last bag of Roman oodles and noodles was what saved me tonight from being hungry. That's not going to happen. Not going to happen. We're going to solely depend on the Father of Yahuwah, where nobody can say, listen, you know what? My hands brought me this far or that far. That's the way it's going to happen. All right?
So, he's actually going back where he was dealing with him.
Yes, absolutely. Amunah, that word right there is going to be very important. That word, that's a whole other lesson. Emunah is the word faith. And Yasharal don't have faith. You know, that's the problem. And again, that's another lesson within itself. Yet faith is going to be the key. Now, let me try to finish this up here, all right? We in Leviticus, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. And Moshe called Mishael, and Eliphaz, the sons of Uzziel, the uncle of Aharon, and said unto him, come near, carry your brethren from before the sanctuary out of the camp. Get them out of here, let's continue. So they went near and carried them in their coats out of the camp, and Moses had said, and Moses said unto Aharon and to Eleazar and unto Ithamar, his sons, uncover not your heads, neither rend your clothes, lest you die, and lest wrath come upon all the people, but let your brethren in the whole house of Israel bewail the burning which Yahuwah hath kindled. And you should not go out from the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. Down to 15. Where did I stop at? Verse 7. Of congregation, you should die. For the anointing of oil of Yahuwah is upon you, and they did according to the words of Moshe. And Yahuwah spoke to Aharon, saying, this is where it gets very interesting yet now. Do not drink wine nor strong drink, thou nor thy sons with thee, when you go into the tabernacle of the congregation, lest you die. It shall be, which is in parentheses, a statute forever throughout your generations, and that you put difference between set apart and things that are not set apart, and between unclean and clean, and that you teach the children of Yahshua all the statutes with which Yahuwah has spoken unto them by the hand of Moshe. And Moshe spoke unto Aharon, and unto Eleazar, and unto Ithamar, his sons, that were left. Verse 10. Take the meat offerings that remaineth of the offerings of Yahuwah made by fire, and eat it without leaven beside the altar, for it is most set apart. And you shall eat it in the set apart place. The word clothed, because that's what we're looking at. The word clothed. I think I passed it. The word clothed.
That's in 6.
It's in 6?
Yeah, please rent your clothes.
Right, rent your clothes. So what do we have here? No, that's not the one.
Verse 5.
I get back to it. That appeared because that should be the word lavash, cloth, cold. I get back to that one. Verse 12. And Moshe spoke to Aharon and to Eleazar and to Ithamar. I did that one already. Verse 13. And you should eat it in the set apart place, because it is thy due or duty, and thy son's duty or due, of the sacrifices of Yahuwah made by fire, for so I am commanded. And the wave breast and the heave shoulder shall you eat in a clean place, thou and thy sons and thy daughters with thee, for thy due and thy son's due, and are given out of the sacrifice of peace offerings of the children of Yasharal. The heave shoulder and the heave of the wave breast shall thou bring with the offerings made by fire of fat, to wave it for a wave sheaf, a wave offering before Yahuwah, and it should be thine and thy sons with thee for a statute forever, as Yahuwah hath commanded. We talked about the word clothe, and we talked about an important word there. We talked about shoulder, and the shoulder of an animal. So we see now, whenever we're doing offerings, we have now a shoulder of this particular animal now being waved as an offering, or a shalom offering, or a peace offering. So we have now, in the book of Genesis, okay, we have Adam and Eve, okay, the Father clothed them. We went into the definition of the word clothe, and we have the word shoulder of an animal. The animal that was sacrificed on behalf of Adam and Eve, this temporary atonement, the question then becomes, what happened to the animal, okay, that was actually slaughtered on their behalf? You just don't throw the meat on the ground. You just don't throw the blood away. And the blood is a whole other thing, where the blood is supposed to be actually poured upon the altar. So what we're trying to say now is that the Moedim, The festivals existed from the very beginning, and this is how we can get into the whole story with Cain and Abel, how they offered their sacrifices. So again, what I'm trying to show here, okay, is how when you look at it in Hebrew, it is so much different. It's different. All right? So, that word clothed is the Strong's number 3847. We see that the Father is actually clothing Israel. Let's go to Ezekiel 16 and 10. Watch how this all ties in like a hand in a glove. We can't make no mistakes with this. The book of Ezekiel, the 16th chapter. The 16th chapter, the 4th verse. Remember when the punishment was announced to Adam and Peor, or Adam and Eve? Dust you are, and dust you shall return. It's the same story, but a different backdrop. Watch what's going to happen here. Again, the word of Yahuwah came into me, 16 and 1, the book of Ezekiel, the book of Ezekiel. Again, the word of Yahuwah came into me again, to me saying, Son of man, call Jerusalem to know her abominations. Thus saith Yahuwah Elohim unto Jerusalem, thy birth and thy nativity is of the land of Canaan. Thy father was an Amorite and thy mother an Hittite. As for thy nativity, so watch what's going on here now. They're about to be expelled from the garden. So, and as for thy nativity, in the day that thou was born, thy navel was not cut, neither was thou washed in water, nor supple, thou was not salted at all, nor swaddled at all. None I had pity unto thee to do thee any good. I'm going to read down to 10. See, let's just skip down to 10 right quick. It says, I clothed thee also with broidered work, and showed thee with badger skin, and I girded thee about with fine linen, and I covered thee with silk. Do you see what was going on? I mean, are you able to see the parallels of Adam and Eve being clothed in the garden? And when the Father initially called Israel to be a nation, he's also now clothing them. So this whole clothing or covering of the nation of Israel, and so now we have Adam and Eve no longer in the light. We still have the Father showing mercy to this woman, because when I first met you, you was of the land of Arica. In the day that thou was born, thy navel was not cut, neither was thy washed in water to supple thee. Thou was not swaddled at all. Your mother was a Hittite. Your father was an Amorite. Did I have that backwards? Excuse me. Thy land of Canaan, thy father was an Amorite, and thy mother was a Hittite. So again, in verse 10, again, this is the same Hebrew word. When you go to the book of Exodus, the book of Genesis, when it talks about I have clothed thee, it's the Hebrew word labash. When you go to now Ezekiel, the 16th chapter, verse 10, it says, I clothed. It's the same word, labash, and we still have the same thing where the Father is now covering the adulterous woman, which is the nation of Israel. Okay. I'm going to have to shut this down because I didn't know. I have a whole lot more here. Because we're now, so I came at, where are we at with time?
It's an hour and 17 minutes.
Okay. We was talking about this light, okay? I just want to make sure. KAH. This light right here, we're talking about a particular type of light. The Aleph, the Hu, and the Resh. Okay, the Aleph, the Hu, and the Resh. And now we want to talk about how important this light is. Moshe and the burning bush. First fact, watch this. This is the first fact. Moshe, first 40 years, was centered around receiving the best education on earth, which was Egypt. However, all these worldly accomplishments were not suitable for the spiritual work of Yahuwah. Everybody agree? Fact number two. Moshe needed an additional 40 years, this time in isolation in the desert, to spiritually mature and transform his life to become the vessel of Yahuwah. Moshe is now 80 years old. Fact number three. Moshe struggles with us, the nation of Yisrael, in the wilderness for 40 years and unsuccessfully is able to bring the body, the nation of Yisrael, into the land of Canaan because of Marah. The word Marah in Hebrew is rebellion. Right? Rebellion. So as we can see, Moshe's life is broken up into increments of 40, right? Okay, so we have three sets of 40. 40 times 3, as we know, is 120. Right? We can go to the book of Bereshit, the 6th chapter. If we can have Yehuda to actually bring that one into play for me. The book of Bereshit, the 6th chapter, verses 1 through 3.
Six, 1-3 reads, "And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of Elohim saw at the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them women of all which they chose. And Yahuwah said, My Ruach shall not always strive with men, for that he also is flesh.
Uh-huh.
Yet his days shall be 120 years.
120 years. So again, every single thing connects.
Wow.
Okay, so we have now Moshe in his first 40 years. Okay, he's living up in Egypt. Okay, the second 40 years, he's in the wilderness. Okay, getting himself prepared to work for Yahuwah. And then his final 40 years, okay, he spent trying to bring the nation of Israel into the promised land. Yisrael was delivered out of Egypt during a jubilee year. Moshe was not able to bring Israel into the promised land, and Israel was born into the promised land under Yahusha, or Joshua, or Hoshea at that time, during Yovel. Okay, and so I'm just trying to show here now is that the 120 is actually talking about 120 jubilees. This is what this is saying. And if we can get the count right in regards to when was, how the jubilees are kept, especially with our captivities, because every single time Israel was delivered out of a captivity, they were always delivered during a jubilee year. Okay? And we have a jubilee year coming up real soon. Alright, very, very soon. Now, I am not telling anybody. Alright, listen, you know what? Go ahead and
sell
everything that you got. Okay, we went through that before.
Yes.
Okay, we went through that before the year 2000. That's it. People cursed out their mamas. Alright, left their jobs. I mean, didn't pay car notes, rent, and everything like that. This is back when I got started. Okay, he can testify to this. 2000, that's going to be about it.
Yep.
And then a whole lot of craziness went on, and then come to find out, the next morning came.
Question, the individual that gave you guys that message, was he buying up everything, or was he going also?
The
message to sell everything.
Oh, no, enough. As far as I know, yeah, he still had his apartment and his car and things.
Okay.
Yeah, he still had his things. You know, but a lot of this was happening down at the One West camp. You know, these things was rumored that was going on during that time here. So the Jubilees are going to be very important, Mr. Picard. Very, very important. Let's go to the book of names. Okay, we're going to ask for Brother Aharon
Naomi?
Yes, this, Exodus, the third chapter, verses 2 through 6. No, actually, let's have Brother Yaakov do that. Exodus, the third chapter, verse 2 through 6.
Exodus chapter 3, verse 2. And the angel of Yahuwah appeared unto him in a flame of fire.
Right, a flame of fire. Because we want to always make sure. I'm trying to show this right here. Who is this light? All right? So, read it again. One more time for me, please.
And the angel of Yahuwah appeared unto him.
The angel of Yahuwah. The messenger of Yahuwah. Read on.
Appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moshe said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when he saw that he turned aside to see, Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moshe, Moshe. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Draw not knee hither, put off your shoes from off your feet, for the place whereon you stand is set apart ground.
Mm-hmm. Right. How many times did you call for Moshe?
Twice.
So you ever notice a lot of times we might say Shalom, Shalom?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So yes. Anybody know why we do that? Yeah, peace speaks. That's exactly what it means. But what it's like a more extension of the word where we just want to make I'm sincere about what I'm saying. Shalom, shalom. You know, I'm real sincere about the whole thing. Just like you might have the word ach, which means brother, but it gets more personal when I say aki, my brother. It's more loving. You know, this is like, it's almost like impersonal. But if I say aki, you know, this is where I'm now, like, wow, this is my brother. You know, this is my heart. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, when you see this right here, I keep my brother.
So, like, somebody in the family, really, somebody outside of the family, say, ah.
Yeah. You know, you can do that. But this is where it gets personal. You know, when you add the ya or the yo to it, it's like, you said, my isha, my brother, my house. You know, it's now personal. Okay, so I just wanted to say real quickly about the burning bush. When you look at a burning bush, it is not uncommon in the desert, neither is it uncommon here in the States. When the weather gets extremely warm and there's been a lack of rain, that we have brush fires. However, this bush was not consumed. My argument is the fire, the light, the aura is Yahusha HaMashiach, as prescribed in Bereshit, the 15th chapter, verses 17 through 18. If I can have Yaguran to bring that out for me, please. Okay? I'm going to try to knock this thing out of the ballpark. The word or. Oh, this is or. Excuse me?
Which scripture?
Oh, the book of Bereshit, the book of Genesis, the 15th chapter, verse 8. We'll be talking about this light. And this is the Aleph, the U, the Resh. And the reason why we're not pronouncing, is the reason why this is not akur is because these are two vowels. The aleph is a vowel, the ul is a vowel. So it pretty much, basically, we didn't even go through our Hebrew alphabet today, if I'm not mistaken. So what you're actually doing is just pronouncing it this way, or.
In the verse?
Excuse me? We're going to the book of Bereshit, the 15th chapter, verse 17 to 18.
And it came to pass that when the sun went down,
mm-hmm.
and it was dark,
mm-hmm.
behold, a smoking furnace and a burning lamp that passed between those pieces.
So we all see how important this light is. We have the light now that's going between the pieces now, and these pieces that the light is going through, this is a covenant that the Father is trying to make with Abraham. It's always about the light. Always, okay? Read on.
And
that's it?
In the same day, Yahuwah made a covenant with Abraham, saying, until I see, I have given this land for the rivers of Egypt, until the great rivers of the river Euphrates.
Hallelujah.
And the Kenites, well, that's it, yes.
Oh, that's it. Oh, okay, hallelujah. I just want to show again, we're talking about a burning furnace. We're talking about a light. We're talking about Adam not having, losing that light. We talked about Yahusha being the light. We are to walk in the light. The light is Yahusha HaMashiach. There's a light that's going between the pieces that's making a covenant with Abraham. You keep saying this light, this light, this light, this light. You go to the book of Bereshit, the first chapter, the third verse. It said that there was darkness and void and darkness upon the face of the earth. So we talked about last week, Tohu and Bohu. And it said now that the light came, the light came, now we have this orb or this light in the middle of this darkness. Then we went to the book of John last week when it talked about Yahuchanan was not that light, but he came to testify of that light, and that light was Yahusha HaMashiach. So it's always about the light, the light, the light, the light. All right? We see this whole situation again about the sacrifice being made in the garden. We talked about Adam and Eve but once being enlightened or lightened beings, okay? But they lost the light. All about the light here, all right? So, the book of Judges, the 13th chapter. Okay. And the children of Israel did evil again in the sight of Yahuwah, and Yahuwah delivered them into the hand of the Philistines for 40 years. We talked about 40 times 3 represents, is 120. So we see now the number 40 also represents atonement. Okay? So again, in the land of 40 years, so they could be punished for their atonement, for the sin that they committed. And there was a certain man of Zorah, of the family of the Danites, whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren and bare not. Now, it's been rumored that a lot of the teachings that men do are they're male chauvinistic. It's only talking about the men, the men, the men, the men, and women are not being brought out. Women are not being brought out effectively to show their roles in the walk. We don't do that here. Anybody know why, for the most part, the names of the women are not mentioned? Because we have a situation right here, I'm going to read it. There was a certain man of Zorah, of the family of the Danites, whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren and bare not. Why wasn't the woman's name mentioned?
Because of Eve, because of going back, and then, the way that everything is set up, the father, Yahuwah, Yahusha, then the messenger, then man, then woman, then children.
Right, exactly, exactly. I hear what you're saying.
What do they call it? Feminist and the other word, masculinist.
Is it moving by the seed?
Did she come on in the
generation? Is it for generations?
Well, that could be a problem. We'll see that too loud. Don't see that too loud. Okay. The reason why we have in a lot of the stories where the wife is not mentioned is because the woman, she was such a reflection of her husband. I mean, it just almost like goes without saying. If you have seen me, okay, you have also seen my Isha. You're not being left out. The two should become one flesh. You're not losing anything here. You're really not losing anything. This is one body. This is the reason why Yahusha HaMashiach can say the things that he say. And then those who don't believe in the Messiah, they say, listen, you know what? The Messiah said that he can save or he can redeem you. But nobody can redeem you but the Father, which is correct. But the Messiah is speaking on behalf of the Father. And so the Isha can speak on behalf of the husband because they're supposed to be both a reflection, of one another. Nobody is losing here. Nobody is losing. But if you're blind, if my gospel be hidden, it's hidden from those to those that are lost. Because they're going to now look at this and say, you know what? Oh, that's a male chauvinistic book. That's what's going to happen. But again, we have to look at the scriptures from the Hebraic perspective. You're going to lose otherwise. Okay, and the messenger of Yahuwah appeared unto the woman and said unto her, behold, now thou art barren and bearest not. Thou shalt conceive and bear a son. Now therefore beware, I pray thee, and drink not wine nor strong drink, and eat not any unclean thing. For lo, thou shalt conceive and bear a son, and no razor shall come on his head, for this child shall be a Nazarite unto Elohim. From the womb he shall begin to deliver Israel, or Yisrael, out of the hand of the Philistines. Then the woman came and told her husband, saying, a man of Elohim came unto me. So we see how this is working? The messenger came to the Isha, the woman. But this is not taking anything away from anybody, because they're all working in one accord. This is about them too, so nobody is losing out here. If I was a male chauvinist, I could say, well, listen, you know what? I'm pissed off, I'm angry, and I'm mad. Well, it's not about why you're mad. Because the messenger came to my Isha and didn't come to me. Right. See, it doesn't make sense. When you see me, you see my Isha. When I see you, I see your Isha. When I see you, I see your Isha. That's how the whole thing works. You wouldn't believe. But anyway. Then the woman came and told her husband, saying, a man of Elohim came unto me, and his countenance was like the countenance of the messenger of Elohim, very terrible. But I asked him not whence he was, neither told he me his name. But he said unto me, behold, thou shalt conceive and bear a son, and now drink no wine, nor drink or strong drink, neither eat any unclean thing, for the child should be a Nazarite to Elohim from the womb to the day of his death. Verse 8. Then Manoah entreated Yahuwah and said, O Yahuwah, let the man of Elohim, which thou didst send, come again unto us and teach us what we should do unto the child that should be born. And Elohim hearkened to the voice of Manoah, and the messenger of Elohim came again. We need to identify who is this messenger, all right? Because there are many messengers. We need to know who is this particular messenger. The woman, as she sat in the field, but Mona, her husband, was not with her. And the woman made haste and ran and showed her husband and said unto him, behold, the man hath appeared unto me that came unto me the other day. And Manoah arose and went after his Isha, or his wife, and came to the man and said unto him, art thou the man that speaketh unto the woman? And he said, I am. And Manoah said, now let the words come to pass, let that words come to pass. How shall we order the child, and how shall we do unto him? And the messenger, we need to identify who is this messenger. He is the messenger of Yahuwah. He said unto Manoah, of all that I have said unto the woman, let her beware. She may not eat of anything that cometh of the vine, neither let her drink wine or strong drink, nor eat any unclean thing, all that I command her letter observed. Verse 15, and Manoah said unto the messenger of Yahuwah, I pray thee, let us detain thee until we have made ready a kid for you. A kid, so they're about to do the sacrifice here. Okay. And the messenger of Yahuwah said unto Manoah, though thou detain me, I will not eat of your bread. And if thou will offer a burnt offering, okay, thou must offer it unto Yahuwah. Alright? So we have this messenger acting on behalf of Yahuwah. So when this messenger is speaking, it's not the messenger's word, it's Yahuwah's word. Alright? So you're the man of your house. Alright? You give the instructions. Now business needs to be taken care of. You're not in the house. Isha is now speaking first in the first person singular, but she's speaking under your authority, so it is actually you that is speaking, but you're not there. You're the mediator. This is how this works. Watch how this goes on now. Verse 16, and the messenger said, I read that in verse 17. And Manoah said unto the messenger of Yahuwah, what is thy name? So he wants to know the messenger's name. Okay, the name. That when thy sayings come to pass, we may do thee honor. And the messenger of Yahuwah said unto him, why askest thou after my name, seeing that it is a secret? Okay, watch this. Let's identify this messenger. He said, we have the Fe, the Lamed, the Aleph, and the Ayin. Okay, we have Pile. Okay, Pile. And the word secret means this man's name is who do you know?
Wow.
Okay. Who was given this name as a secret because it could not be revealed at that time. But you know what? I'm going to go to, anybody know what the word sun means in Hebrew? The sun level of understanding?
Secrets.
Mystery. A mystery is a secret. It's a secret. So I'm going to tell you who I am, but I'm going to tell you who I am in a parable. So you might not be able to see it now, but those of us that have the true understanding of Scripture, we would know that when we do our research, okay, that his name is called Wonderful. Wonderful Counselor, Prince. This is all referring to Yahushua HaMashiach. You can't miss here. You really can't miss if you look at the scriptures from a Hebraic perspective. That Western Greco-Roman stuff is not going to make it. It really isn't. This is the reason why. If you ever see a person not growing, it's because they're not willing to commit totally, I'm going to break it down, into Torah. All right?
Would that be a directionary precept on precept?
And you know what? Precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little. I get into that next week, but promise, make sure I don't forget it. But that's the way that I was even taught back in the day. Yeah. When you go a little scriptures here, a little scriptures there, that's fine. But there's even a more better understanding of that because it's talking about measuring the scriptures. That's, and I'll leave you there for now, okay? Because I don't want to go off into a whole other lesson, because you know who I am. I'll keep on going. Okay, so we have the word Pele, which means wonderful, incomprehensible, and extraordinary. It means remarkable. It just goes on with all of these characteristics that they're showing Yahushua HaMashiach. I mean, that's what's going on here. I'm going to shut it down because we're already at the second hour, right? Okay, we finish up this here and I'll finish up the rest next week because we still have a whole lot left. Okay, I stopped at verse 19, was it? 18. So Manoah took a kid with the offering and offered it up upon a rock, and the angel did wondrously. Mona and his wife looked on. And it came to pass when the flame went up toward, listen to what's happening, verse 20. When it came to pass when the flame went up towards Shamayim, emphasis are being placed upon where it went. It went in the direction towards Shamayim, from off the altar, that the angel of Yahuwah ascended in the flame of the altar, and Manoah and his wife looked on it and fell on their faces to the ground. So this is all being about being illuminated. And we see this being now, who I believe to be Yahushua HaMashiach, he goes into the flame, okay, and he ascends back up to the Father, and he left you a message that his name was called Wonderful.
Wow.
Okay, so we have a little bit more. 1 Chronicles 21:26. Just let me know when it stops, okay?
Mm-hmm.
21 and 26?
Yes. So to begin, even with the burnt offering or this sacrifice that was being made, what I'm trying to do is link everything back together, because in Genesis, the 15th chapter, it talked about an offering being made, a covenant being made with Abram, right. And it talked about again about a burning furnace, okay, upon these sacrifices now going between the pieces.
Right.
So what I'm trying to show here now is that we have to know how to put the pieces of the puzzle together. All right, when we begin to talk about lights and these things of that sort, because I have just to say the Messiah is the Messiah is the light. You say, well, you know, you have to show me some proof of that. But let me try to speed this up again. 1 Chronicles 21, 26. And David built there an altar. These altars are that's a whole other lesson too when we get into the word altar. You got 10 minutes. Okay, I'll do it another time. Altar. And David built there an altar unto Yahuwah. He built an altar unto Yahuwah and offered burnt offerings and shalom offerings or peace offerings and called upon Yahuwah and called upon the name of Yahuwah, and he answered him from heaven by fire. Okay, upon the altar of burnt offerings. Now, in Philo, I'm going to say this. In Philo, the burning bush represents Yahuwah's mercy. The bush represents the nation of Yashra'al. Okay, again, the bush represents the nation of Yashra'al, and the flame surrounding the bush represents the affliction we faced in Egypt. Again, the flame surrounding the bush represents the affliction we face in Egypt, and the bush was not consumed because of the Ruach HaKodesh. Okay, that's the reason why. You sons of Jacob, you are not consumed. It's the same word consumed that's used in the book of Malachi 3, I think it's 3:16 or 3:9. Yeah, it said, you sons of Jacob are not consumed. So the bush was not consumed because of the ruach, okay, that was surrounding the bush, kept the nation together for the purpose of delivering her, bringing her to Mount Sinai, and making a covenant with her. All right, this is what this means. Nehemiah. I'm going to end it there, okay?
Because I know he says in one verse, I said, this ruach before you, he's the leading guide, and then
beware,
he will not pardon your transgressor.
Exactly. Because we have this smoking furnace throughout this description. It's all over the place. You see, when Yahshua is being delivered out of Egypt, okay, we see the smoking furnace or this lamp, okay, guiding Israel during the nighttime hours, okay, and then we see a pillar of cloud by night. So this light now that is always, Israel is always following, this light was the prophetic shadow picture of the Messiah.
Right, right.
You know, that rock that they followed, that rock was Yahushua HaMashiach, was the Messiah. So, you know, the book of Nehemiah, let's go to... Anybody have Nehemiah, the ninth chapter?
Ninth chapter, one verse.
Okay. chapter, verse 7 through 8. You have that, Shaul?
Yes, I do, sir.
Okay.
Thou art thou art Yahuwah, the Elohim, who didst choose Abram and broughtest him forth out of Ur of the Chaldees, and gave of him the name of Abraham, and foundest his heart faithful before thee, and made a covenant with him to give the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Jebusites, and the Girgashites, to give it, I say, to his seed, and has performed thy words, for thou art righteous.
Hallelujah. So we see now that the seed must continue. Okay, then Israel is not consumed. And one more, the book of Isaiah 51 and 2. Let's get a sister for that. What about my sister Shai?
What
chapter is that? You're going to finish it off for us with Yeshayahu, the book of Isaiah.
Certain things, maybe the Mashiach, maybe he'll turn and offer an offering for the Father on your behalf.
Yes.
It's a class that Maury had called.
I'm about to let Maury come up and do some closing words here. All right. I'm gonna let Maury come up. I think, was there anything else that needed to be brought out? Is something that was a question? Because I was gonna try and find a scripture where it says that your brother, the accuser, is cast down. Yeah, here it is here. Verse 12 and 8. I started verse 7. It said, there was a war in Shamayim. Michael and his messengers fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was their place found anymore in Shamayim. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called Ashatan, and Satan, which deceived the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a voice saying in heaven, is this one?